Corinthians chapter 1, 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Verse 9, Reverend Blanche, Reverend Johnson, thank you, Pebbles, you did a masterful job today. God bless your heart. To Brother AJ, God bless you. To Brother Kenny, Brother Joe, Mass Choir, deacons, officers, la-di-da-di, everybody. We can get out by 12:30. I think I can do this. I can do all things through Christ. Okay, let's try 12:40, just in case. But I feel like preaching here. 2 Corinthians, chapter 1, verse 9. Indeed, we felt that we had the sentence of death. So that we would rely not on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. You may be seated. I want to talk about I can depend on God. I can depend on God. Just look at somebody and say, neighbor, I can depend on God. I can depend on God. Brothers and sisters, I have been raised to be independent. My father taught me the value of having a sense of control over my life. In fact, we were raised, Tasha, on the value of never allowing situations to master you. However, most of you are aware that recently my life had been turned upside down by the challenges of anxiety, panic attacks. This form of illness caused me to feel as if I had no real handle on my own life. There were good days, Deacon Lynn, but there were far more days of terror and worry in my own life because there was no real awareness as to how to deal with what I was dealing with. We have been talking about making faith fun again, church. We have spoken about celebration, evangelism, and family. But today we're forced to grapple with a harsh truth. And that truth is that our faith journey will not always bring us to places where sometimes our life will bring us to places where we will not have control. Can I get some witnesses in here? Anybody on my left side can testify that there'll be some moments where you cannot help yourself. That ain't my crowd. Come on, left right side. Anybody on the right side can testify that there are moments where you just don't know what to do. You are perplexed. You are trying to figure things out. Anybody can testify that there are moments in your life when things will get out of control. There'll be times when you feel like that you have lost hope and of regaining a sense of stability. And oftentimes, we hear sermonic presentations talking about the importance of manifesting faith through relying on God's ability. Nevertheless, there are moments when we have to ask the question, is relying on God really worth it? I don't know about y'all, but brothers and sisters, I've heard sermons, I've heard preachers preach, and they talk about the importance of trusting in the Lord with all of your heart and leaning not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. I've heard people say that God is faithful, but there are some moments where I have to really call that into question. God, can you really be trusted? Y'all sit up here acting like y'all don't know what I'm talking about. But is there anybody up in the room that can take off your sanctified church hat and say that there's some moments where you really don't know whether you can trust God? Y'all ain't saying nothing. But is there anybody in here that's ever walked through a valley, ever walked through some painful experience, and you said to yourself, I've heard Sister so-and-so, Pastor so-and-so talk about trusting in God. I've heard them say you can depend on God, but I really don't know if that's the case. Y'all too saved for me. I need some real sense. I need some real folk that don't mind testifying and not testifying this morning. Like you said, I've been down to my last hour. I have been broke like this. No church change. I've been strange. And I've had some people walk out on me. I've had some people get on my nerves. And there were days when my body was racked with pain. And I had to ask the question, can God really be trusted? He's put me in this mess. Put me in this trouble. Put me in this, all of these bad experiences. And can God really be trusted? Slap the neighbor, say neighbor. I don't mean slap him, I mean slap him high five. You got your neighbor, say neighbor. Pastor, feel like preaching today. Can God really be trusted? Because I don't know about you, but there are moments, thank you, Reverend, but there are moments where our life sees me on a downward spiral. There are days when you just don't know whether it's really worth it needing to trust God or whether to go on and do your own thing. This seems to be the context of our conversation in the book of 2 Corinthians. Paul writes this letter from Macedonia as he makes a defense of his apostolic ministry. There were those who had emerged, and there were false teachers that were in the church that were saying that Paul was not an authentic apostle. These persons relied heavily on letters of recommendation as a form of validation. These persons looked and thought that the basis of who they were was based on people's assessment of them. And I need to pause parenthetically and say this, that if you only think you're worth something based upon what people think about you, you are sorely jacked up. Because let me tell you something, don't you ever define your worth based upon somebody else's assessment. I am somebody, not because of what you said, but because of who I am in Jesus. Can I get a witness in here? And whether you like me or not, I am who I am. We're jacked up with flaws and alls. Is there anybody in here that can testify that you can either take me or leave me? It really won't matter, but at the end of the day, I'm going to be who I'm going to be. Slap somebody high five and say, look at this, neighbor, take me or leave me. I ain't changing for nobody. And you better get to that place where you say to yourself, I ain't changing for me, because watch this, you ain't really worth all that. You ain't all that plus some. You didn't save me. You didn't call me out of darkness into his marvelous love. I am who I am because. These people, depending on their oratorical ability, they could talk well. They could use language very well. They sought to defame Paul as a coward who was a letter bully. They said that Paul can talk good when he writes a letter, but when he gets in front of people, he talks like he acts different from his letter. And so, such persons could only boast about their abilities that they made. But Paul takes a different route in this letter, and he decides to show that the power of God is shown not through your ability, but your inability. You see, you know that God is with somebody, not because of what, because, now let me sisters. Your anointing is not in your ability to use two and tricky phrases, but your ability and your anointing is demonstrated in your ability to handle the hard times. Because anybody ever can get up in here and try to make people shout with two and tricky phrases. But at the end of the day, how is your life after you come out of the shower? That's where the real power is. When God's power can be shown through your weakness. When you can see God work even through your sickness. That's when you can say that God is awesome. Because when God can use people who ain't got it all together. Anybody here can testify you ain't wrapped too tight? Oh, ain't nobody gonna say nothing. Anybody can testify you ain't wrapped too tight? Come on, you look special. Uh-huh. You got the sharpest pencil in the box. You are jacked up from the floor, but God uses me not because of me, but because of his grace. This is a point that is hammered in this book, but also in this passage. Paul is continuing this discourse on suffering and comfort, which he started in verse number 3. God is praised for his involvement in the drama of human life, giving them the ability to find and give comfort. You see, when God is involved in your life, you can find comfort in God, but also give comfort to others. This conversation is applied to a specific reality that may not have been known, that may have been known by the church. Paul speaks of an affliction, verse number 8, and this is confirmed by the lack of precise. We don't know what the affliction was. There are those who say it was a physical ailment, it was persecution. At the end of the day, we really don't know. But whatever it was something that was horrible. One can guess that Paul was on a missionary assignment and encountered some painful moments, which reveals that, brothers and sisters, on your journey of faith, sometimes you will be brought to a very low point in your life. Anybody can testify that since you've been saved, you've had some up days and some down days. Let me back up, drop it like it's hot, and say it again. Anybody who can testify that you've had some moments on your Christian journey when you want to give up on your faith, want to give up on, come on, don't you act sanctimonious or something. You know what I'm talking about. You've had some moments when you said, Lord, I'm about to be up out of this piece. I'm done with the church that I'm done with, because I'm going through too much. I've had some good days. Let me try to. I've had some hills to climb. I had some weary days and some sleepless nights. But when I look around, when I begin to look around, I just start to get together and begin to think things over. All of my good days, I'll bring my bad days. I won't complain. Sometimes the clouds hang low. I can hardly see the road. I begin to ask the question, Lord, why so much pain? But he knows what's best for me. No, I cannot see. An interpretation of the horror, and God's unique intervention in life. We don't know where this exact location took place. We don't even know the nature of the pain. On the contrary, Paul describes the pain in very graphic details. He says, we were utterly, unbearably crushed. Verse 8b, we despaired of life itself. Verse 8b, and we felt that we had received the sentence of death. We were on the verge of death. Has anybody in here ever been brought face to face with death? Face to face with you. And I'm not just talking about the very physical nature of death, but the very spiritual nature of death. You just felt like getting away, being separated from. Is there anybody that's ever been at that place where you despair of even life? And there might be somebody right now that's at a place where you said, I'm despairing of life even now. I am sick and tired of being sick and tired, sick of hurting, sick of crying, sick of being broke, sick of the children, sick of the spouse, sick of this, sick of that, sick. has received the sentence of death, which speaks of a decision given in response to a request to be positive or negative. Paul gives the lesson that results from this trouble. Paul shares that this event was designed to enhance his awareness and dependence on God. Let me stop right there. Paul says that I got so close to the point where life, where I was in, was almost inescapable. I did not, there was no hope for me. But I got to a place where I could not help myself. I could not do anything for myself. I was totally out of the picture. And sometimes God has to take you and put you in a posture of helplessness. When you don't know the answer, you can't figure out the problem, you ain't the strategist. Sometimes God has to put you in a place where you can, because the human tendency is when you got control over everything, what you will do is you will boast about it. But he says that our hope and our reliance is on God who raises the dead, which is a prominent theme of this letter. What he states is that God is able to do what no other power can do. That if he brought me close to it, if it's his divine will, he can bring me out of it. There is nothing impossible for God. And he says that God, he uses three tenses of deliverance. He said, God rescued us, will continue to rescue us, and he will rescue us again. That the same God that did it before is the same God that can do it right now. Anybody here can testify that if God did it before, he can sure enough do it again. Because Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. We're not permitted to know how God delivered Paul. But the important part is that God showed up in a miraculous manner. And what he does say, this extended, he brings the discussion to a close by saying, listen, y'all can get involved in this, verse number 11, by participating by the ministry of praying, which inspires others to give thanks to God for his blessing granted through the prayers of others. There is a problem that I need to talk about in this text. I got a problem that I need to wrestle with for just 10 minutes. Problem is I have in this text. The problem is that there is a tension between self-reliance and reliance on God. This is a constant human conflict. Now, please, there are days when you and I are tempted to rely and trust in our own self. See how that quiet you got on me right there? See, just proved my point. Because you all got quiet on me. I know that proved my point right there. All of us have the tendency because we relish the idea of having control over ourselves. In fact, we look with disdain on anyone who projects an image of dependence. This, however, Paul seems to be arguing that reliance on God is helpful for the Christian journey. That you show your real strength not when you trust in yourself, but you show your real strength when you rely on God. So how can relying on God be helpful during life challenges? How can relying on God help me when I'm going through? I'm glad you asked. I'm going to give you the answer. We out of here. Relying on God, Sons Ray, reveals the limitation of humans. Someone shout, limitations,
limitations
of humans. That is, you can't do everything. Just name this term right there. You ain't all that. Paul, let's take a survey of Paul. Paul had every reason to place confidence or trust in himself. He was highly educated and zealous for the law. He could speak several different languages. This man had the ability to speak to the Jews and to the Greeks. This apostle could lean on his own merits and accomplishments. That is something real, because all of us in reality have made some accomplishments. Some of us are in a place right now where we're making think is, or at least trying to get there. Some of us are in a place where we're so smart that we're too crazy. Yet, can I get a witness in here? All of us, listen, all of us have something that we can brag about. You see how quiet you got on me again? You see how quiet you got on me again? All of us got something that we can brag about. Listen, we either got a good skill, we got a good ability, we can talk ourselves out of poverty, we can work ourselves out of poverty, we got a lot of money, we can pay ourselves something again, okay? We can pay ourselves out of... to have so much to lean on that one can almost rely totally and put God out of the picture. And that's what ego is. Ego is easing God out. It is the proclamation and articulation that I got this. And sometimes God gotta put you in a place where you don't have this. Show you that, listen, it really ain't about you. Can I get a witness in here? Anybody can testify that sometimes what God will do, he will put you in stuff where you are good, where your credit will be jacked up, where your life will be jacked up, where people will leave you high. And can I get a witness in here? Because there's some of us who trusted in people, and as soon as they came in your life, talking about they'll never leave you, they just as soon as they said it, they were gone. That, you know what I've discovered somewhere? That's why you can't depend on people. Yeah. Yeah. I thought I'd get a lot of amen, amen. Because people are fickle. People are wishy-washy. They don't want to believe me. Because people, listen, they'll say they love you for it. And then by you do something wrong to them, they will leave you and they will talk about you. Can I get a church up in here? Anybody ever had people around you that thought they said they were with you? They were going to ride and die with you. Just as soon as you went through, listen, you told them, but they told you you can call them anytime. But as soon as you called them, 7123, sent them a text message, they blocked you. But I'm so glad that Jesus is on the main line. And you gotta get developed a thick skin. Stop letting people's departure get to you. Let me deviate from your sermon for a second. Stop letting people who walk out of your life get to you. Because listen, if it was meant for them to be in your life, they would have no doubt stayed. You gotta get to the place now. Listen, if you wanna leave, go ahead. Listen, save the trouble for you. Oh my God, is there anybody in here that can just say, I've developed a no-nonsense attitude in 2018? Listen, if you for me, then you gon' ride with me. But if you're not for me, listen, let the dark night hit you with a good loss. Charges that seem to threaten Paul's very well-being. The incident in Asia was one of those experiences where Paul came close to death. In fact, Paul came to the point of exhaustion where he couldn't take anymore. Have you ever got to a place where you just couldn't take anymore? Just tired of crying, tired of fighting, tired of the struggle, tired of the pain. Some of you come in church, and you are physically, emotionally, and spiritually tired. You come to church every Sunday, but when you come into, when you leave, nothing seems to change. You are depressed. You are broken. Your people don't know how much crying you do. In fact, you got so bad that you use drink. You use called to escape reality. Some of y'all sunk into a place where you are so exhausted that you look for a sexual pleasure to fulfill your other preach like I feel. Hey, Jesus. Some of y'all are so depressed and so exhausted that you're at a place in your life where you just say, I better take my own life. I'm so sick and tired of being sick and tired. Tired of being depressed. Tired of feeling lonely. Tired of feeling like nobody cares. Tired of fighting with people. Tired, just tired. Tired! Sick and tired. Sick and tired. Sick and tired. I'm tired of the lies. Tired of the games. Tired of all the stuff. And y'all got other adjectives y'all want to use. But I'm tired. Oh, begin to have a despair for life. Death seemed to be looming over him. It seemed to pose an obstacle to his faith journey. Nevertheless, Paul found in God one who could deliver from the grip of death, which caused him to proclaim that God will rescue him from danger, which is an indication that God's got power to deliver. Now watch this. God's power to deliver does not mean he'll always deliver. Sometimes God's greatest mode of deliverance is giving you grace to handle what you're going through. God, can I preach like I feel? Can I say it again? That just made me want to preach again. I'll say it again. Sometimes God's delivering power is not him bringing you out of the situation, but giving you grace to deal with the situation. Listen, I am where I am, not because God changed the problem, but he changed me. I don't know about y'all, but Sister Gloria, I've been changed in some things. Let me testify. Hold up. Let me testify. You all know, I told you earlier, I've dealt with the challenge of anxiety. There were days I prayed for God to move it. Prayed for God to take it away. Prayed for God to just listen, give me relief. Because there were days I had an impending fear of a whole lot of stuff. Just afraid to go day and after day because I was afraid of what life could bring. And then I had to learn a valuable lesson. God told me one day, boy, I'm not going to take you in this. I'm not going to take you out of this. But I'm going to give you strength to live with it. And the word of the Lord came to me that I will keep him in perfect peace. How Sunday after Sunday I can mount this pulpit and preach like I ain't got no sense. It wasn't me, but the grace of God. Let me tell y'all something. Some of you are always complaining about what you're going through. Let me tell you something. Shut up. I'm going to give y'all permission today. Look at your neighbor as a neighbor. Whatever you complain about, shut up. Because can I help somebody? All of us got this, but all of us got something. Let me move. When you feel like you can handle everything, that leads to arrogance and pride. And some of us are too arrogant. Some of us are too conceited. Too many of us think too much of ourselves. We think we all that. Look at me. Where there is a realization that we are not always at our best. Today, somebody needs to come to a place where you just declare, I'm not always at my best. I don't always feel 100. And can we just keep it real? Some days you want people to just encourage you. And some days move you along. Just got a divine email. Because, Tasha, here's what bothers me. When I'm going through, I don't want you coming quoting Bible to me. I'm a preacher, I know Bible. You know what the Bible says, Pastor. Sometimes, what can I tell somebody something? Sometimes I just want you to listen to me. Vent. Just sometimes your greatest encouragement is when you learn to just shut up and let me vent. Listen to me. Don't always give good advice. I'm looking, I'm moving. Lynn, everybody don't give good advice. And you gotta be careful of advice that you take from people. Because everybody isn't worth listening to. Let me move. But one more thing, that reliance on God is helpful because it helps us, it reaffirms the value of prayers from others. That there is power when people pray for you. Paul concludes this conversation about suffering and God's intervention with an appeal to the Corinthians to join as partners in prayer. And this partnership is with God. So what Paul is saying, church, when you pray for me, you are actually joining in partnership with God. You are praying, and watch this, be careful about who you ask to pray for you. to pause right through here and say this. If you can't pray for yourself, listen, I ain't got nothing to talk. Listen, and watch this. Everybody, Sister Humphrey, everybody who's praying for you is not really praying for you, but praying on you. Pause, rewind. Can I say it again? Everybody just took that same. They're praying for you. I'm really praying on you. They're not praying P-R-A-Y-I-N-G, but they are praying P-R-E-Y-I-N-G. Everybody ain't worth. Everybody can't pray for you. You hear what I'm saying, church? There's some of you guys say, listen, don't pray for me. I'm good. No, I'm good. Please, please, please. In fact, you got to be careful. Well, I'm going to say this again, and I'm out of here. That's why, church, we don't let anybody that don't know it unless it's me or somebody I designate lay hands on you. Even in my circle, let me get back in. But when we pray for one another, it reveals that all of us are connected to one another. That's what it should do. When your brother or sister prays for you, it's a reminder that we are, because of Jesus, are related to one another. And that there is power. And so, saints, let me challenge you. For those who actually pray and mean what they do when you pray, when somebody asks for prayer, listen, don't just say, oh, I'm going to pray for you, but take some time and pray for them. You don't get tired of folks going, I'm going to pray for you, 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 I'm going to pray for you. And just be lying. Watch this. And then when you ask them, have you been praying for me, they're going to sit right there up in your face, and I been praying for you. Knowing good well, they ain't been praying for you. Let me get out of this, I'm tired now. But there is power in, and that means that we are connected. When you pray, pray for God's will to be done in a person's life. Can I get a witness in here? That's what you be praying for. Pray for God's will to be done in somebody's life. If you don't have anything else to pray for, and pray that God will get his glory. Pray that God will get the honor. So the text lets us know, brothers and sisters, that our faith, reliance on God, is formed through our traumatic experiences. It teaches us that we are weak of ourselves. We cannot handle our own situation. We cannot handle our own problems. But it also teaches us that God, that there's somebody that who can pray for you. No wonder Dr. Norwood would say, somebody pray for me. Pray for me. Yes. Is there here? Anybody can testify? You can't live it longer. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
second call. So anybody here who's saved, but you're not in the church, or you're being led to become a part of this church. We're not a perfect church. I'm not a perfect pastor. I will say this. We didn't change that. No, I'm not a perfect pastor. But I'm perfect for this church. Can I say that again? You know what? I just discovered something in my thoughts. No, none of us are perfect. But when God has brought you together in perfect unity, you are perfect for this church. There you go. So maybe here, when you come for baptism, come from by letter or from Christian experience by letter, or you want to come under watch care, you can come right now.
Keep us and we shall be kept, blessed and we shall be blessed.